Team 8-5, happy remote learning day number 15. I'm outside, and if you hear motorcycles and cars, the road is not that far away, so I apologize. It's actually Thursday evening for me, and I had a little free time, so I thought I might try to make my video now. But you're watching this, it's probably May 8th or 9th, but it's meant to be watched on Friday, which is tomorrow for me. Today you'll be reading three short documents. The first one I want you to read is called the Treaty of Versailles. That's how you pronounce it, Versailles. Like a sigh, Versailles. The second one is called the Policy of Appeasement. And the third one is called Hitler's Actions. We're going to go back in time a little bit, back to the end of World War I, because our next unit, you know, our next few days, maybe 2 weeks, will be World War II. But I want to explain things that happened that helped cause World War II. So the Treaty of Versailles was signed on June 28, 1919. It was signed in Paris with dignitaries there, and kind of opinion, but it's one of history's most hated treaties because, yes, the treaty formally ended World War I, and it was called a peace treaty. But at the same time, it laid the foundation for the Second World War. Because of some of the things we did wrong. And of course, hindsight's 20/20, which means you can always look back at your mistakes. But before you make your mistakes, you don't always know you're making a mistake. So the big four would be the Western leaders, and the Western allies won the war. So Woodrow Wilson of the U.S., David Lloyd George of Great Britain, George Clemenceau of France, and Vittorio Orlando of Italy. A lot of people, if you do extra research, will say that it was the big three because Orlando of Italy wasn't that involved. Everybody wanted Germany to accept blame for World War I, that was put in the treaty. Woodrow Wilson wanted the treaty to be fair. You know, he didn't want to make it so hard that Germany couldn't recover. But France was angry, and the leader of France and the people of France wanted revenge. Great Britain, the people of Great Britain wanted revenge, but the leader, David Lloyd George, he felt like Woodrow Wilson was right. And Woodrow Wilson had 14 points. And when they finally decided what to put in the Treaty of Versailles, a lot of Wilson's 14 points were not put in there. And that was one of the mistakes. So the four main terms of the treaty, I did more research myself, and some people say there's three main terms, but basically there's the war guilt clause, which means Germany will accept the blame. It was their fault. Hence the word war guilt. Reparations is really just making people pay for something that was their fault. So in the treaty, we wanted to make Germany pay, because it was their fault, so they should pay money to fix what they caused. Disarmament, probably you know that one without me telling you, but basically it's to reduce your military and your weapons to make your military smaller and take their arms away. And there's a territorial clause, well, or many clauses, where we took certain land away from Germany. Like Germany couldn't unite with Austria anymore, which was called Anschluss. We took away parts of Czechoslovakia from Germany, things like that. So territorial clauses. So those are the four main terms. And there's a bunch of questions about those four terms in your Google form. At the signing of the Treaty of Versailles, they forced the German leaders to sign it, and they weren't very happy, but they had no part of the negotiations, none. And this angered Germans and the people of Germany, the politicians of Germany. Everybody was pretty unhappy. Right away, Germany became very poor. I mean, it probably was poor from World War I already. They lacked the basic needs and things like food, and they even called the writers of the treaty criminals. So as time went on and there were some new leaders elected in different countries, they tried to write the policy of appeasement. And appeasement just means to pacify or to placate by giving in to somebody's demands. picture a little baby, you know, wanting a toy, and you're so sick of the baby whining and crying for the toy that you give the baby the toy. That's kind of like appeasement. Giving in to someone provided their demands are reasonable. Giving a baby a toy is reasonable, wouldn't you say, to stop the screaming? These new politicians realized that it wasn't fair. So this is the key, you guys, this is key. They started giving in to Germany. One of the disarmaments, there was like a rule in there. They could only have no submarines, zero. But they could have like four large ships in their army. And I think they could have like 300,000 soldiers. I might be wrong about the number. But this young man named Hitler was starting to come into power, and he started rearming Germany. And some countries knew about this, and they just kind of ignored it and gave in. And then Hitler started putting some of his troops back into the Rhineland, which separated him from France, which France wanted, so Germany couldn't attack France so easily. Great Britain felt that giving in to Hitler's demands would prevent another war. And even Hitler himself said, I promise. One of his last things he said, he did a lot after he broke his promises, but before he broke a lot of promises, he asked for the Sudetenland back. And he said, that's my last claim. I won't do anything else. And they said, okay. So they gave him Sudetenland back. And what do you think Hitler did? He started, and Sudetenland is an area around Czechoslovakia. And sure enough, after they said, okay, there won't be another war, they gave in to Hitler. And Hitler, after that, started attacking Czechoslovakia. So he wasn't a man of his word, and he didn't do what he promised he'd do. So your last document is called Hitler's Actions. And it's a little bit of a repeat about the appeasement paper. These are all really short readings, but give them a good read, you guys, because it's going to make the assignment much easier. But it is a bit of a review. You'll when you read it, you'll feel like that's what you read in the appeasement paper. Let's see. I did a lot of thinking about my song today, and I'm outside, obviously, and it's really warm when the sun comes out, but I've had a lot of clouds. And I've been chilly. So I thought, I know, I'll do my favorite song from my favorite musical, Annie, and The Sound of Music's my other favorite. And my favorite version of the song Tomorrow was by a young girl named Andrea McArdle when I was a young girl, and that was on Broadway. So you probably know this one too. And here comes the sun. Okay. The sun'll come out tomorrow. Bet your bottom dollar that tomorrow there'll be sun. Just thinking about tomorrow clears away the cobwebs and the sorrow till there's none. When I'm stuck with a day that's gray and lonely, I just pick up my chin and grin and say, tomorrow, tomorrow, I love you. Tomorrow, you're always a day away. Sorry, guys. It's one of my favorites. And look, the sun is out. Isn't that exciting? Woohoo! Anyway, let me just give you a little bit of Andrea McArdle's voice. She's pretty amazing. So she did that on Broadway live, and that little dog is called Sandy. Anyway, if you get a chance, watch any version of Annie on TV. It's really a great musical. So happy remote learning, and the sun will come out tomorrow and each day after that. And I hope that you guys are all good and know that I miss you so much. Happy learning, guys. Bye-bye.